my friends. This is Wolfgang with Tools for Ascension. And today it will be an interview. An interview with Robin Wattler. You know, Robin Wattler actually will interview me. But first a question to her. I mean, this is going to be about empaths. So Robin, what about you and empaths? How did you get into this?
Well, I have a background in psychology, primarily studied addictive disorders and energy healing, shamanic healing, but I'm an empath myself. And in the type of work that I do, I did find that empaths have no clue. I mean, I had no clue for the longest time how to navigate this reality, because we're constantly taking in things, energies, and emotions from other people. And from even Gaia at this point in time, I mean, we always are bringing in the energy of Earth. With the ascension and everything that's going on, I found that empaths were struggling to know how to navigate this life. So I created Empath Central, where I do life coaching. And basically, I'm a guide for empaths.
Okay, well, thank you so much. And so how come that you ask me questions?
Well, I came across your YouTube videos, your meditations a while back, and they were incredibly powerful and healing for myself and my son. And we did some sessions with you, and I started to realize the vast amount of knowledge that you have. And 40 years of spiritual training, and you offered to allow me to interview you, and obviously you're an empath yourself. So I'm excited to get input from someone with a background such as yours on how to navigate this reality.
Yeah, I mean, the more questions you ask, you know, the better. We all know, you know, glass half full, you know, half empty, or, you know, if you know everything, or if you think you know anything, you're not learning, you're not widening your horizon. So I like your attitude, you know, of continuous research, you know.
Yes.
So go ahead and ask your questions.
All right. Well, the first one, in your opinion, what is an empath?
Well, I would say everybody is potentially an empath. You know, it's just on a sliding degree, you know. So I consider empaths somebody that's very sensitive. So you're having, a scale from dull to extremely sensitive, just like a mic. You know, you can have like a large ribbon, very sensitive mic, and that would not do very good in a heavy metal concert, you know. And if you want to, you know, do a mic, the drums, especially the kick drives, you want to have a dynamic mic that's kind of, you know, doesn't get blown out by those high pressures. So in nature, I think, everybody is super sensitive, especially the prey animals, you know. I mean, deer are very, very, very sensitive, tuned into everything. So in my opinion, most animals are empaths, you know, even birds. I had a session with a client in Australia, and we were doing it in a park. And when we were, in a love vibration, the birds would just beautifully sing along, you know, very loving expressions. And when there was a harsher energy, you know, harsh past lives, there was dissonance and alarm calls, etc., in the environment. I mean, it was just amazing how the whole environment. And, you know, these birds were like 20, 30, 40, 50 yards away.
Wow.
Uh-huh. So also, in my opinion, a dog will first of all sense your fear, you know, before he feels your fear. And also, in my opinion, you know, horses are super sensitive. I mean, they're, I think, looked down, you know, on humans as emotional barbarians. I have to say, you know, I mean, once I had this epiphany, and so I could see, you know, how harmonious they were just standing next to each other, how they were running love between each other, and they had their back turned to the humans. You know, I mean, we need an attitude, you know, we don't want to have nothing to do with your whacked out emotion. I mean, this is Germany, you know, they're very uptight emotionally. They're very traumatized, you know, so I understand. So I think, you know, the natural state of being, you know, is that you're very, very sensitive. But then, you know, this gets stunted. You know, through generations and generations and generations, right? I mean, and you can see it in many cases in the upper lip. You know, I mean, this is probably very controversial or news, big news to most people. But in my observation, and I mean, I studied this intensely since I was about 16 years old. Wow. The more the upper lip comes up, you know, is inflated, and the more sensitive a person is.
Wow. You know?
And the more receptive, you know, towards the positive. You know, nowadays it gets artificially, you know, enlarged. So it's right. Kind of confusing, you know. Is this person actually sensitive? But, you know, that's how you can see it. And if somebody has a tight upper lip, you know, you can be sure that, you know, something really bad happened that offended the sensitivity of this person.
Wow.
But I mean, yeah. so, like, yeah, so in so many lifetimes, you know, or most people in this lifetime, you know, the sensitivities, you know, have been offended, like a sensitive child gets yelled at.
Yes.
And that is very shocking, very shocking, right? And so empaths is also, of course, connected with emotions, you would say. And you know, when this is uncovered, when all the trauma is being removed, you will also see other, let's say, mystic powers coming up. So you not only feel how the other person feels, you have synesthesia, so that you know, see it through other senses. But go ahead before I get ask me another question.
That's fascinating, actually. I appreciate your description. That's really interesting. On the topic of empaths being so sensitive, obviously, we hate disappointing others. I mean, everybody does, but with empaths, we really have a hard time with that. Because we do feel other people's emotions so deeply, just the thought of hurting somebody else's feelings can increase anxiety for us. And saying no sometimes makes empaths feel really guilty. So what is the best way that you know of to handle saying no without guilt and anxiety?
Well, good, really good question. So I have to say that in some cultures and some ethnicities and also in some religions, you know, the cultivation of guilt has been perfected to an art form.
Yes. Absolutely.
So, I mean, people are programmed, you know, by guilt, you know. I mean, it is a non-violent, less abusive form of control.
You know? Absolutely, yeah.
But then also it's very subliminal and therefore difficult to, you know, detect the shackles of it, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, guilt tripping is better, you know, than getting beaten on a regular basis. Yes, I mean, let's just be clear about it, you know. So, but as a sensitive person, you know, so you experience, you know, all emotions basically on steroids, you know, super amplified. And it's like slightly tripping on LSD, you know, and LSD and other drugs, you know, where you get, you know, connected to the, you know, to all that is, to reality again.
Right.
You know, you, I mean, this is kind of an insight of how you're living on a, in a higher dimensional consciousness, actually. You know, you're connected to everything, you can feel everybody. And of course, you want to be in a good environment, just like an empath. You know? And especially little babies, you know, they don't have this shield around them. They don't have a strong force field. So they're super open. So they're super empathic. So that's why you always want to have them on your body or in your bed sleeping next to you. I mean, I had so many clients that get, you know, attacked by ghosts as kids. You know, they're empaths. You know, the ghosts know, they can see them. Their parents think this is all, you know, childhood fantasy, those stupid kids. And they get abducted and scared.
Absolutely. I've seen that as well. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, it's barbaric, you know, the way children are being raised nowadays.
Absolutely.
And so when with negative emotions, you know, you can hurt an empath. You know?
Yes.
It's much easier. So, you know, basically, you know, you do a stern third eye and then you put in, you know, your solar plexus, you know, and you can cook an empath like that. You know?
Yes.
I mean, you don't have to hit him or whatever. You know, or through other, you know, mechanisms of guilt tripping somebody. You know, remember when you did this or that, or when you promised me this and that. That's basically like a martial arts, you know, of guilt tripping. You know, in this situation, you apply this, and in this situation, you apply that, and you block this with that. You know, it's martial arts, mental martial arts, or emotional martial arts. So whenever, you know, you say no or do something they don't want, you know, you got to expect this kind of things. You know?
Right.
So you have to become really good at saying no, first of all, in a very deflective way. I mean, deflective, you know, being funny, charming or whatever. You know, so you become an expert at it, like the song, you know, there's 100 ways to leave your lover. You know, so, you know, so it becomes, you know, like a no, a big deal. You know, imagine you're a barmaid, you know, in some country serving out and, you know, men coming on to you all the time. You know, you better get it down to say no without offending those guys.
Right.
You know, so it's just, you know, this is a life skill, you know, you have to, you know, develop.
Absolutely.
So I used to tutor kids, you know, for math. So, and, you know, they wanted to become bankers, so their whole future depended on it. They would fail, you know, doing the tests. So I realized they knew the math, but then they froze. So, you know, in that high stress situation. And so I started giving them, let's say, one little thing, you know, to do, like one question to solve, like in a test, but then put them under stress. You know,
right.
Oh, you got only, you know, 60 seconds, you know, 45 seconds, 30 seconds. Oh, you never do it. I can never do it. You know? And then, you know, and so, yeah, did they do it? You know, good, very, very good. You know, so well, now we're going to make it more difficult. You know, in the end, I had them with headphones on, rock and roll music on, pointing, you know, chasing them. Hey, you know, and so the other tests, they were like perfect. You know, the teachers thought it's cheated, you know, but they just kept their cool. You know, they were used to it.
So practice.
Well, practice and making a game out of it. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like, I mean, those kids knew it was not, I mean, I was just making this up, you know, I mean, I didn't traumatize them, you know, this was all tongue in cheek. I made sure this was tongue in cheek, but to do tongue in cheek, you know, it's like sparring, you know, it's like, oh, Barry, you know, how about do my laundry for me today? Well, give me 10 ways of saying no.
Right.
You know, make it more funny. You know,
make
it more less confrontational. You
Absolutely.
Know, so, you know, do like the jiu-jitsu, you know, or aikido of saying no. You know, I mean, and then also putting, you know, stress on bad emotions and, you know, training basically blocking, to, you know, this is like breath work, should be done. I have videos on this, how to do so. But an empath definitely should also, you know, learn breath work. So as an empath, you better learn the tools.
Mm-hmm. That's for sure.
Yeah. Otherwise, I mean, you know, it's like you have to learn how to keep your car locked, you know. So if you're an empath, you know, there are certain things you got to do.
Yeah.
And one really important thing is, you know, as an empath, you have to understand when you smile, you know, you deflect negative energies. Yes. And so when you frown, you know, you attract negative. I mean, they get into you. You know, mm-hmm. So to keep smiling, especially when you say no, the negative emotional reaction of the other person, you know, does not affect you. You know, that's a big, big, big important trick.
I appreciate knowing that. In the past, I always thought if I said no and I was smiling, I wouldn't be taken seriously. So when you told me that a while ago, or I had read it, or I think it, no, you had told me. I started using that method. It helps a lot. So I appreciate the knowledge.
Humor, too. I mean, you know, with humor, you soften any situation.
Absolutely.
You know, if you can make it really funny, you know, it's just people cannot be angry. But, you know, of course, you got to be appropriate.
Right. Right. Absolutely. So another question for you. How can an empath navigate being in an environment that is crowded, noisy, fast moving, without becoming overwhelmed?
So yeah, we're not living in nature anymore, right?
No.
So yeah. So as an empath, you will thrive, of course, in a loving, harmonious environment, you know,
absolutely,
like you find in nature or so-called holy places. You know, that's even better, you know. And there, you know, you open up, you know, and you inhale, you know, the love of the trees or, you know, other beings, and you send love out. You know, that is the great advantage of being an empath, you know. So nature always has been, you know, a refuge to me when I was down. I couldn't really, you know, count on humans. So, you know, nobody wants to be around you when you're down, right? So I always felt better in nature. So because there's harmony. So when you're in a negative environment, there's basically, it's a thing of balance, you know, which is stronger, the emotions or the chi that you generate yourself, is coming out of you, and then the chi and the vibrations that's coming into you. Mm-hmm. And so you have to learn how to create a force field around you where only your stuff is in. You know, that you create your own inner cocoon, your own inner sanctuary, your bubble of your emotion and nobody else's stuff. And I had to train very hard. There were times in my life where I had to work as a printer, which is a very, very frustrating thing. So, you know, especially when you print, you know, difficult things. Where a lot can go wrong, and it's very noisy, a very toxic environment.
Yeah.
And I had to learn how to keep my heart open and my crown chakra open in those circumstances. So it was good training.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, so you really have to pump love there. So of course, now, just to give you a little outline here, you know, you want to, as an empath, you want to use earth energy to protect yourself, you know, mostly. The earth energy is strong and thick, and is great for cleansing and protection, you know. And so children, you know, are an empath, you have to, you know, learn how to ground yourself with breath, you know. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
you still will be able to feel other people, but they do not sway your own emotions. You know, you are strong. It's not that you dull out, you know, you just, your own light becomes strong. But you can also help, like with diet, you know, with gems and minerals. But in my opinion, you know, good breath work is essential, you know, in control of your energy body, and it's less entangling on the long run. I mean, I have gems, you know, I mean, I tried it all. I mean, I really stick with gems, but yes. I'm not carrying them around, you know. So when
right.
I, a printer, you know, breath is all I had pretty much. Yeah, you know, I could bear some stones under my shirt.
Right.
You know, so where nobody, oh, that's why I have military pocket. I have minerals.
That's perfect.
Yes. So I was always loaded in that sense. And so this helped. You know, normally, you know, you kind of breathe yourself like an egg, a golden egg of protection. But when you're in really in crowded spaces, like a mall and whatever, you know, people would get into your force field. So there's a trick where you just imagine you're having an astronaut suit. You know, it's just a shorter, more compact buffer. You know, and actually statistically it has been shown that people living in New York have a more compact aura than people living on the countryside, you know, where they're not.
That's interesting. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. We advanced.
Well, I don't know how short our attributes to personality, right?
Right.
Or to prejudice.
Right.
Or New Yorkers. So, and also, you know, there are things like Merkabas, you know, that you can spin around yourself, or a violet light, you know, to purify or visualizing columns of light. I have several videos, you know, on this. They're short. Just go to my channel. And so you have to train again, you know, to be comfortable in situations. And so then you have the confidence. You know, right. It's not just reading in books about it. You know, that's just like doing martial arts by shadow boxing. You know, you have
right.
to hit punching back at least. You know, you have to, or you at better if you get battle hardened. You know, somebody really attacks you, you know, without your style, without cooperation. You know, then you really know whether, you know, your style is good. So in the same way. You know, this should be battle hardened. You know, that kids, okay, I'm going to yell at you. You know, now my mommy loves you, but I'm going to yell at you and you get your protection up now, you know, and then, you know, and see, so how did that work? You know, all right, let's do more breath of fire, you know, and let me know when you're ready, you know, and then again, you make a game out of it. You make it a good experience.
Yeah. Absolutely. So. It does help to practice and to know how to handle it ahead of time, like you're saying. Yeah. Absolutely. So in light of that, what are some effective ways to protect your energy when you're in a situation with an energy vampire? Like short term? If you're like out at a restaurant with someone that's an energy vampire for an evening, or long term, if you live with or work with one?
Yeah, well, living with one, that's quite a problem, you know, to sustain that, I would say.
Yes.
Well, I used to, you know, manage a New Age store for a year. I had to deal with all kinds of clients. I mean, and this was the only New Age store in Tucson at the time. So there were a certain type of clientele. When they came in, you know, my solar plexus chakra started hurting. You know, so
yes.
These were the dark magicians, you know, the energy
yes.
vampires. And it became quite obvious, you know, the way they acted. And so there were some easy ways to defend yourself. Well, you know, every defense, you know, of course, can be overcome. It just only goes so far. And I have videos on this, but let's to be very fast. So one is, you know, you want to protect your solar plexus. That's where your power is. So you just cross your arms over it. You know, this is protecting yourself. You know, the next one is you turn your side to them.
Aha.
So, and talk to them like this, you know. And the next one is that you cross your legs so they don't have access to your root chakra either. And, you know, and then the next is like more in the realm of visualization. So, I mean, first of all, best is to just get up, you know, get out of there if you can.
Yeah.
If you can't, you can visualize a mirror. But you got to constantly maintain this, you know, and you will see right away, you know, and feel it in your energy, whether it works or not. Or brick walls are good. When they're really in your solar plexus, you can also visualize the fan, like chopping it off.
Nice.
Or force fields. Let's say Jupiter rising, you know, you have this super soldier there, you know, and you see those shields that come up, you know. Yeah, this is what to visualize, you know, a shield like this, you know, that nothing negative gets through. And also, you know, avoid eye contact.
Interesting.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, they can, you know, you can pick up a lot of stuff, or a lot of stuff can dumped into you, get into you through the eyes. So avoid eye contact. Yeah, yeah. Especially when you see a demon jumping at you from somebody, you know, avoid eye contact.
Yeah.
And again, you know, hook up with earth energy. You know, earth energy is this strong, and then using this. Then you, yeah, this, that's pretty much it. You know,
yes. I mean, those are really good tips to know. That's interesting about eye contact, too, to know that. So another question, how can an empath handle criticism in a healthy way, because we are so sensitive? I mean, everybody struggles with handling criticism on some level. But when you're super sensitive, how do you handle it?
Well, you know, personally, I always say, and I found it true in my life, you know, it takes a great soul to take criticism well. I mean, a great soul, you know, especially men. Especially men, you know. I mean, even if it was, the criticism was invited, you know.
I mean,
even like, you know, the art professors at my academy, you know, most of them wanted their disciples to be a decal, you know, a copy of themselves, you know. I mean, and they didn't see the egotism in this. Yeah.
Wow.
I mean, I lost respect for those guys.
Yeah.
And I mean, my one, he was special, you know, so he furthered everybody in his own thing. He was super intelligent, an awesome guy. Tim always on the way. So criticism, you know, always hurts the ego, you know, the personality, you know, and yes, basically you tap into issues like, you're not good enough. Damn. Right? I mean, you know, if you have lots of trauma, that's not being good enough. Well, how was the cake? Well, you know, it could have been sweeter, or that, you know, not good enough. You know, this is all the pain when you got dumped because you were too fat, or you weren't funny enough, or you didn't have a car, you know, not good enough. So every time you criticize, you know, you plug into this, you know, and so that hurts by the film. You know? Then also, you have to distinguish, you know, as if you're sensitive. So this would just be your ego. This has nothing to do with emotions, you know. But you have to see, you know, this criticism, you know, is this polemic, you know. That means unfounded, you know, and just, you know, meant to insult you. Well, you're a bitch, you know, or, you know, you're stupid, you know, without giving any, or this is, you know, against the moral norm. You know,
right.
So, you know, things like this, you know, could you please qualify, you know, this accusation? Mm-hmm. And so this is, some of them is just to hurt, you know, of course, you know, this is just an energetic attack. So it has to be seen as this and not just, you know, take it literally, you know. Or, you know, maybe it's based on reality, you know, and we have been acting like a bitch or this and that. And I don't want to offend any female dogs. So, and so, I mean, there's really, you know, there has to be this self-reflection. You know?
Yes.
And then, of course, we have to apply the standard of what is right or wrong, you know, and always, of course, always question authority. I mean, you know, ask your inner self, you know, your higher self. You know? So I take criticism as a sounding board, you know, if it's meant seriously.
Right. Right.
And so that's how you learn, you know, to rectify yourself. I mean, when you get a personal trainer, I mean, you basically hire somebody to criticize you.
That is true.
Yeah. But at least they know what they're doing, or, you know, and and not just somebody, you know, that wants to tell you about child raising and they never even had a child themselves, for instance, you know, I mean, that would be not an authority.
Yes.
Okay.
Now, speaking of children, for people that have children that are empaths, and if, as you have said, all of us at some level, we all are empaths. But if you have a child that is definitely an empath and super sensitive, do you think it's preferable to keep the home environment really calm and quiet, or is it better to allow life just to be normal and teach the child how to navigate through it?
Well, the home should be always like the nest, you know, like the place of refuge and regeneration.
You,
like, I think that's just in nature. You know, there are places of coziness and where you sleep. And, you know, and so this is, I think every human being needs that.
Yeah.
And once you regenerate it, you know, that's what they say about what's the difference between introvert and an extrovert. You know, so how do you get your energy? You know, by your being by yourself or by being with others, you know.
So true.
Attention, you know?
Right.
So, you know, so the extrovert, now most of them, they're not even home. You know, I've seen, you know, they're just always on the run, you know, always somewhere else but home, you know, always with other people. So, for them, the home energy doesn't make that much. I mean, they sleep in it. But, so, definitely if you have an empathic child, like with any child, definitely, you know, home, cozy home environment, you know, this means pleasant music, a positive music, you know, positive images on the walls, you know, uplifting, you know, everything that's in there, in their environment should be evaluated. How does it affect your emotions? You know, so if you have like a scary demon thing in the thing, you know, what do you think, how is this going to affect your kid when it looks at it daily?
Right.
You know, so you want something happy, joyful, you know, in uplifting colors, color combination, shapes and forms. And you want to paint the room with love and keep it emotionally or energetically clear. I have several videos on it. Makes a big, 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 big difference.
It does.
And I even charge it up, with love. And so, but of course, now the empath definitely has to learn how to cope with the environment. And so, you know, desensitization is the usual therapy route. You know, I personally, you know, this is, you know, desensitization. You know, getting used to it, yes, but you know, the trick, I think, is to, you know, to teach to enjoy the special flavors of higher energy and excitement, you know, maybe going, you know, to a classical concert or to parties, you know, so let it rip, let's go, you know, out there, let's have some excitement and turmoil, you know, and then come back to, you know, a more sheltered environment.
Right.
But make it, you know, in a conscious effort. So now we're going to go into a turmoil. You know, now we're going to cheer up and let's enjoy this like a roller coaster, right? You know, I mean, if every day to work would be a roller coaster, oh, God, that would just be horrible. But sometimes it's fun.
Exactly. And then you know, they get to practice, too. Practice their putting their shield up or their astronaut suit on, that type of thing as well. Yeah,
and share observation, you know, as an adult energetic observation. You know, see, do you see how depressed this guy is? Do you see how angry this guy? What do you think what's going on there? So, you know, learn their skill of reading people.
Interesting. That's fun.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, reading people is fun. You know, I mean, I definitely want to introduce them also to face reading and, you know, body language reading. You know, so make it, you know, I mean, if you can have powerful observation, you have it a lot lighter, better in your life.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, cool. Now, this next question, I've had people tell me that being or saying that people are empaths or being an empath is just a fancy word for codependent. And I know that empaths, it's much more than being codependent. But what differences do you see?
Well, you know, as an empath, you cannot escape the emotions of your partner.
Right.
You know, so which is an extra burden, you know, especially if that partner is not happy.
Right.
You know. So I would say an empath is a normal human being, and that not being empathic is a sign of having been emotionally crippled.
Yeah.
You know. So codependency, you know, seems to be coming from, you know, addiction. You know, this could be to the love, to the sex, or to security, right? Financial security, you know, well, sex is great, you know, or, right. You know, you need somebody to snuggle with.
Right.
And then also, do you have, you know, abandonment issues or trauma? Mm. Right? I mean, was there a daddy there for you or a mama there for you? You know, maybe right. You're looking for this in your partner, you know, and so you're addicted to this, you know? Or do you have past lifetimes, you know, where you got abandoned? And pretty much everybody had been abandoned at some time, you know? So there's this deep fear there. Or you're not connected, you know, to love yourself, you know? So the only way to feel love is from others. And that's a codependency, then definitely,
yes. You
know? So, I mean, you definitely have to learn how to access, you know, love yourself. That's kind of my mission, I think, you know, how to get in touch with this. And then there are also, you know, vows and promises from past lifetimes many times.
Interesting.
To always be there for this person, to always love them, to always support them. I see this in so many past life regression and when I work with relationship issues, right? And then another thing is like the more the voodoo realm, you know, magic and curses and spells from this and past lifetimes that keep people, you know, connected, bound to somebody else, subservient,
right.
You know, I call those bitch spells.
Yeah.
You become somebody's bitch, you know, like a prison bitch, you know?
Yeah.
And there is, of course, and also, you know, an influence of ghosts from past lifetimes that overlay, you know, their behavior, you know, with their mental telepathy. So, because most people are not even aware of this. Sensitive people, you know, are more open to those suggestions.
Yes.
So this can all be factors, you know, that are part of it. And it's basically learning how to live four and fifth dimensional life as you're becoming aware now of those realms. It's becoming more and more commonplace, common knowledge, and more part of culture, not the mainstream culture yet, of course not. You know, they're trying to suppress this and ridicule this with Scooby-Doos.
Yes.
You know, but people are just waking up and say, hey, what are those phenomena? You know, I got to figure this out.
Yeah, more and more people are waking up, which is nice. Absolutely. So do you believe that empaths purposely choose abusive or dysfunctional families to incarnate into? And if so, why?
Well, you know, that's not really empath specific. Right. I mean, as I said, you know, empath is just probably a normal human being,
right?
You know, or maybe enhanced human being, you know. So most healers, first of all, are empaths, you know, or should be empaths.
Yeah. Right?
I mean, this is where this starts. And so in my work, you know, I find several reasons why traumatizing families members are chosen. You know, first of all, there can be, you know, heavy duty past life karma. You know, some of this was very, very violent, especially with fathers, etc. You know, another big thing is a wounded healer lesson. You know, so you know, you are traumatized as a child, and then you have to learn how to overcome this, you know, and then you can heal others, you know, because you have learned it yourself. It's not no more armchair philosophy. Mm-hmm. You know, so yeah, I suffered a lot in my life, I have to say.
Yes. You know, so,
and I have been in so many different jobs and stations in life and seen countries and different cultures, so I can understand a lot because I went through this myself. So yeah. Then another thing is, you know, I mean, there can be like lessons, you know, that the soul wants to have. And yeah, the soul doesn't care that much for the suffering of the incarnate, you know. So like learning how to forgive. So, you know, let's say abusive parents. Yeah. You know, you not only maybe you abused them in past lifetime. That's one thing, you know. Oh, yeah. You know, you wanted to help kids that have been abused by their parents. So you went through this. So that would be another thing, you know. And then, oh, no, you just wanted to learn how to forgive, you know. Oh, yeah, this is, you should see people when they talk to the eyes, say, what? You know, and, or stand up for yourself. You know, that's another thing, you know, putting up healthy boundaries, borders, you know, or to love yourself, you know, to learn compassion. And so that's, you know, this whole self-improvement thing, going through a voluntary lesson. And then there is this other department of, you know, family or personal curses, you know, that also, you know, maybe condemn you to always have partners or parents that are abusive or not properly fitting and things right. like this.
Right. So it's not empath specific, the abusive situations.
One in three women gets raped, you know.
Right.
You know, and I mean, in a past lifetime, that was a lot worse.
Absolutely.
For sure. You know, so.
Absolutely.
Now, everybody suffers. You know, just feel, yeah. Some feel it more and some don't. And so that the ones that feel it more, of course, they can feel the joy also more.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So that's the thing. As an empath, you know, you can go really down and you can go really up. You can say this has been the advantage of being bipolar. You know, you can take it.
Why not?
You can go really high, you know, if you can take the down.
Make the best of it.
Yeah. Enjoy the down. Just take it as a roller coaster.
Totally different topic, but in your experience, are most empaths star seeds?
Well, I can only, you know, speak from my personal experience, you know, with my clients, which are, of course, not ordinary people. I mean, they're no statistics as such, right?
Right.
And, right. So, if you're eyeball deep, you know, in the matrix, you know, in the Maya, you know, first of all, nothing I, you know, say will make sense to you. So, so my clients, you know, I mean, most of them, you know, they're empaths, you know, but some, you know, are blocked, you know, to trauma, you know, again, vows, curses, black magic, you know, or even certain technologies. And once those have been removed, you know, they come back, you know, to this feelings of a wide range of emotions. You know, this is why I test people's heart chakra at the introductory session, right? I mean, can you attest for this?
Absolutely, yeah.
So I would say that, you know, they are all empaths because this is part of a higher human being, you know, and it has been crippled, you know, but they are absolutely.
Yeah, interesting. Now, with all of the intense energy that Earth is experiencing right now and the human collective is experiencing right now, how can empaths handle all of this energy on a daily basis in a healthy way?
Well,
it's a lot.
Being healthy, but let me just put out, you know, the stuff that's not so commonly known. You know? Mm-hmm. So as an empath, you know, you definitely have to ground. You know, it's imperative that you ground because you're so receptive. You know, and because you tend to absorb, you know, negative energies more, especially if you're not constantly smiling. Those negative energies, they get discharged automatically when you connect to the earth. And so people, you know, in the good old times, you know, you used to walk like 5-10 miles every day. You know, this was just part of common life. Mm-hmm. Or they had to work in the garden. Yeah. Or in the field, so they were grounded like gangbusters.
Absolutely.
Especially if you went barefoot, you know, you got a foot massage, you know, and so they were emotionally balanced. You know, I mean, just take a walk in the forest, and you know, once you come out, you probably feel better. You know, so grounding is super, super important, especially if you sit in an office building with concrete floors and on a computer, you're not having even a cardio going.
Right.
You know, I mean, you gotta go out and, you know, work at least a workout, you know, in a gym or do some kind of a jumping, bouncing. Mm-hmm. And another thing is, I mean, sunlight.
Yes.
Sunlight is a medicine. First of all, it produces D3, you know, really important at these particular times. Now we get into the flu season and we have already a really strong flu going around, right? So sunlight, really, really important every day, unless, you know, vitamin D3. And again, you know, happiness, you know, keeping the inner child happy. So again, nature and dancing, good music, right? I mean, having a good soundtrack to your life makes a big difference.
That. Good soundtrack for our life. We need that.
make your life into a Quentin Tarantino movie. You know, I mean, not the gore.
No.
Or the over the top, but at least have a good soundtrack, you know, even if you just walking down the street in New York. I mean, look at Shaft, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
The music makes the whole big difference. Right?
Yeah.
And good music. And personally, I like lots of baths, you know, to, again, it resets my whole body, absorbs, you know, the negative emotions that are there, and it's very purifying, you know, I mean, in a chemical way. I mean, you sweat, you know, about half a gallon of water easily, you know, all the toxins come out. I mean, I'm 68 years old.
Yeah.
You know, so it works, you know, baths work. And it's also a deep meditation, you know, so I'll use it as my flotation device, and you know, I can go really deep and do my inner reflection. So, you know, which is, of course, good for any empath to process, you know, what is going on. So I do 2 baths a week, you know. And also a really good thing is fire. So I once talked to a person that was having a home, but he was running a home for like problem children. Mm-hmm. Right? And the only rule was that they had to come and sit by the fire each night.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
And so it would work. It was very successful because when you look at a fire, you start meditating automatically.
It calms you, yeah.
Yeah, you know, you chill out and you connect, you know. I mean, humanity has been around the fire for hundreds, you know. Since we knew fire, right, we have been around. That was our TV, right? So we really, you know, chill out and become introspective and, you know, and even if you don't have who has a fireplace at home, TV screen is fine. You know, you can go up to YouTube. Actually, I published, you know, a video where I, you know, shot, you know, my nice fire and, you know, with a surround, cricket surround sound. I mean, that was
Cool. Sound.
Yeah,
I'm going to have to look for that.
Uh-huh. Cool. Yeah, you know, fireplace meditation tools for ascension.
Nice. Yeah.
So, you know, and just having, you know, the sound around and looking at this is good. You know, you can just have your TV there and have a good evening, you know, with your friends. And it will, you know, create, you know, a different mood. And it doesn't take any effort.
Right.
It's an important thing.
And with the holidays coming up, it'll be festive, too, to have that in the background. And why not?
Yeah. Take advantage of technology.
Right. I'm sure you've noticed as well that many empaths choose careers in caregiving of some sort, either psychology or nursing or even being a babysitter, those type of careers. And what are some ways, or nursing, I've seen that a lot, what are some ways that empaths can keep their energy clear during the day while they're working and thrive in those jobs without getting depleted?
Well, this is something I teach my clients my very first day.
Yes.
You know, you don't give your personal energy. You know, you be depleted really, really fast. You know,
absolutely.
You always take your energies from heaven and earth. There's lots of it there, endless supply. And, you know, you actually get nourished doing this. And it will, you know, when you smile and pump this love into environment, you are a blessing to the world. You know, you'll be a good Christian or good anything. Good Buddhist, you know, anything, except Satanist, maybe.
You know,
they probably frown on that. And you know, and also the dark energies, they do not resonate with you like this, you know. So when you are smiling and I yell at you, you know, Jesus, like, ha ha ha, ha, you know, it does not affect you. So this is one of the best. And of course, you know, when you get home, especially from any, you know, stressful job, I would take a shower with the intent of cleansing my aura and all the negative emotions that are from others. You know, that's a very, very important. And then, you know, you feel definitely, you know, refreshed, you know, refreshed and cleansed.
Yeah.
And, you know, so... But especially in a caregiving job, you know, the best is to just always connect it to heaven and earth and pumping love, especially in those jobs. So you have to be connected to the earth to have the physical strength and to have the healthy boundaries. And
Then
from the heavens, you will be getting, the intuition and the divine grace and love. And you can get a lot of good love from Mother Earth, but there's a different quality to the heaven love, right?
Absolutely. And like you're saying, then you're not depleting your own energy because you're constantly pumping love, and then it actually helps you as well as you're doing that.
This is where the advantage is, you know, of being
wow.
a man. You know, that is where the great advantage is.
Wow.
When
so
you
many
are
miss that
sensitive, you know, mm-hmm. then you can get all this beautiful stuff. You know, the, wow. the more you are less empathic, the less you get that. You know?
True. And
so there are people, you know, when they did this video on the gems, you know, they could feel everything. So this is an advantage.
Right.
This is the joy of the empath. You know, I can enjoy gems, I can enjoy beauty, I can breathe love with the forest. You know?
Absolutely.
And, you know, when you look for a lover, you know, you want to have somebody that is sensitive so they yeah. can, you know, I mean, it's not just rubbing skin. It's just the emotion, you know, of love that is being projected. You know, when somebody can experience this, you know, you have to be very empathic, you know. So you can have great, great pleasure, you know, if you have somebody that has great, beautiful energies.
Right. Absolutely.
And especially now with the heavenly energies that are coming in, ET energies and whatever, you know, as we connect
yes.
now to the Gaia, to the love, we connect yeah. to the elements and the sun and source, you know, and all the beings around, you know, it's mm-hmm. not just transcendental anymore. It's God and nothing in between and us. No.
Right.
It's like all my relations. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So this is an empath, you know, they're in this mode, all my relations, I'm connected to everything. I can feel the clouds, I can feel the tree or this person, this animal feels, and they can feel that too. You know, this is the world of an empath. This is a new 5D human.
Yes,
you know,
absolutely.
There's nothing wrong. You know, this is the updated version, you know, away from like a dragon, mm-hmm. you know, and not to offend monkeys, you know, it's just, and they're probably, again, very empathic, you know, look at, you right. know, gorillas, you know, how soulful they look, you know.
Absolutely.
They're still there, they're not distracted by their mental pain.
Yeah, I love that you're pointing out the positives of being an empath, because so often people focus on, oh, I'm too sensitive, oh, it's too much, you know, but look at the beauty in being able to experience all of that, especially with the new earth energy, like you were saying. I get chills. I mean, it's just so beautiful. It is so absolutely beautiful.
Well, and you see the ugliness of the old earth, you know, the systems
right.
you want to get, you know, rid of, you know, the square, cheap warehouse buildings, you know, like
yes.
last maybe 50 years, you know, the waste. You know, there are, I mean, the aesthetics of cities are just horrible, you know, mm-hmm. in most cases. You know? Maybe in Dubai, whatever, you know, they're really, you know, trying there. I'm not saying this is the ideal way to live, not at all.
Right.
You know, but you know, I mean, you know, all those guys doing the trips into the future, you know, the high-tech future, they have floating cities and nature is pretty much not touched very much, you know.
Wow.
You have self-sufficient systems, you know, in the Star Trek, so-called Star Trek future, you know, but
right.
that's not necessarily the angelic, you know, future, you know, this is more like a materialistic future
right.
timeline, you know. That's another discussion.
It is. It'd be interesting, but I'll try and keep on target here. Sorry about that. So one thing that does come up over and over, or that I've noticed, is all the programming that we all go through, so that most of us don't even know who we are at our core. How can empaths learn who they are at the core of their being? Because we've taken on so much programming from our families, from society, from religion, from everyone around us.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking self-realization here.
Right.
Know their self. You know their self, this Oracle of Delphi. Know their self.
Right.
So, I mean, you know, first of all, let's look at reality. I mean, everybody is programmed, you know, from childhood on
yes.
by the reactions and values of their surroundings and culture. And I mean, mm-hmm. that is a given. You know?
Mm-hmm.
And so to deprogram yourself from these external influences, you know, and finding your essence, you know, has been the work of mystics, mm-hmm. you know, And their paths have been to study, you know, I mean, scholarship as such.
Right.
Drugs, you know, or altered state.
Right.
You know, and a lot of my clients, you know, ayahuasca and, you know, and all kinds of other things, you know, help them, you know, to see reality beyond, to wake up. And, right. And then they come to me. You know, and then we fill that up.
Right. They need somebody to process it all.
Yeah, explain what's going on, you know, and troubleshoot the problems many times.
Right.
And so then, of course, there is meditations, you know, active and passive, which has to do, again, with altered states. But to get to altered states of meditation, it takes much more dedication. You know, that's why many modern people just do drugs, you know, we don't have the time anymore. Yeah, no, I mean, it's not that I'm not recommending, you know, studying a habit of cocaine or heroin. This
right.
is these are not the drugs it's I'm talking
very
about.
Very different, yes.
Yeah, yeah. And be really careful of picking your shaman and don't have sex with them.
You know? Yes, there's that.
I have a lot of issues. I heard here about a lot of issues. On
wow.
This. Oh, yeah, yeah. And, so also, you know, getting in touch with your inner child. It's a lot of the work I do. You know, inner child stands for your inner subconscious, basically. You know, most of your programming is done in the first 6-7 years of your life. Most yes. psychologists will agree there.
Yeah.
So inner child work is really important. Then, of course, inner teen work. So this is kind of, you understand your conditioning, you make friends with them and keep them happy, because you're not going to be happy unless your inner child and your inner teen is happy.
That is so true. They're still there paying attention to what we're doing, that's for sure.
Yeah, and when they're like, you know.
You feel it, yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely, absolutely.
And then, oh no, there's then
yeah,
one more.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, and then, you know, so this is kind of your earthly, and then you get to know, you know, your high self. So the high self, and this is again, you know, as an empath, so you have to be pretty much empathic, you know, to feel the presence of your high self. You know,
yes.
Some of them see the presence, you know, but feeling the presence is like, I think, you know, the beauty of the emotions, of the love that can come through, you know, hard to match this with optical beauty. I mean, you know, they appear very beautiful, but, you know, I think they're always flawed from the emotional beauty. You know, they cry from that, not all oh, looks
right.
So
just you talking about it, I'm tearing up. I can feel it. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, let's go into those places, you know. So this is the highs of the empaths, you know,
yeah.
That you can experience those things. And you're not crippled that much.
Right, right. It's a superpower, really.
It's the first superpower for most.
Yes,
it's
absolutely.
First, you know, they're empaths first. Most people can, you know, they're not even maybe seeing their inner child or see their high self in a form, but they can feel it.
Yes. Yeah.
That's the entryway, you know, to mystical experiences.
Yeah. Interesting. So I don't know if you've ever experienced this, but sometimes when empaths are out at crowded social events, or they've had a long, busy day, sometimes I've experienced it, and I've talked to other people who have as well. Your brain just won't stop buzzing. It's like you're trying to get yourself calmed down for the night, but it's like just a buzzing sensation and you can't calm down. What do you do after days like that?
Well, let me start with a joke here.
Okay.
So one thing you could eat is a big steak, you know, or have a few drinks, and that will dull you down enough, you know, and you will pass out sooner or later. But this is not the method I use.
No.
But let's just start, you know, on the lower scale here, you know. So one way, you know, to pretty much calm yourself down, and even kids, is a glass of hot milk, you know, with sugar or honey. You know, this is in India, they use that. And actually, you know, I thought hot milk, ugh, nasty, you know, sweet.
Right.
Ooh. delicious. I mean, especially really in India, you know, milk is tastier than here, but yeah. It's delicious, you know, and it knocks you out within half an hour, you know, your brain is going to go down.
Interesting.
And so as an empath now, this is, of course, that was just physical, you know. So after work and traffic and, you know, any of those, you know, exciting things, you should take a shower again, you know,
yes.
just to balance your energy.
Yeah.
And but then let's go a little bit more specific. So when you have a lot of buzzing in your head, this means there is a lot of chi in your head.
Hmm.
You know, I mean, your focus is mostly here and not in your toes.
Right.
So, you know, wherever your chi is, you know, yeah, you have more activity there. So to distribute this chi, you know, you do the macrocosmic orbit, you know, which is you pull your energy up, outside up the spine and bring it down up front. I have several videos on it.
Yes, I've seen them. That's perfect. Yeah.
And so that will distribute it. And, you know, it's much more healthy, even if you're on a computer. And let's say you have the hot head and cold feet.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, again, too much energy here, not enough in your physical body, you know, in your lower extremities, and you can get sick really fast then when you have cold feet.
That's true.
So, macrocosmic orbit.
Nice. I love that you have the videos for that. I've seen them, and that's a great idea.
Tools for ascension. Now, you
know, yes. Ascension. Your videos are phenomenal. I just have to tell you, they're so powerful. I've recommended you those videos and you to so many people. So I really appreciate that you've put them out there.
They're made for empaths.
Yes, and they are so powerful. So they're very appreciated, just so you know. In my experience, empaths are more prone to psychic attacks. What are some ways that we can avoid that or protect our energy?
Mm-hmm.
Meditations. Ascension.
Well, so psychic warfare, you know, is a big chapter, you know, when people wake up.
Yes.
You know? Yeah. So suddenly, you know, they become aware of what is going on, you know, on the astral, you know.
Yeah.
And some freak out, you know.
It's yes, just they do.
Very, very shocking, you know. And, you know, yeah, if you go to a psychiatrist, you know.
All kinds of diagnoses.
And, you know, you hear voices. Yeah. Oh, schizophrenic right there.
Right.
You know, for the rest of your life, you know.
Yes.
And, so, but first of all, there is no reason to freak out, you know, because the damage has already been done. You just realized, oh, you know, this is going on. Yeah, this has
now
been
you're
going
just
on
aware.
For a long time. Yeah.
Right.
So, and then, of course, you know, depending on the tradition where you're at, you know, you will find prayers for protection. So, and if those prayers for protection, you know, do not work, then you will have to investigate, you know, by asking your high self, you know, for the root cause of, you know, those attacks, you know.
Right.
And there are, I mean, maybe even use the pendulum, and there are certain, you know, let's say standard things, you know, that would cause this. So there are ghosts.
Mm-hmm.
There are vampiric beings that
yes.
have our energies. There are.
Yeah.
Enemies, you know, that yeah. send haters, that send us bad energy. There are curses and there are technologies. That
yes.
are being, you know, and that's yeah. just a, you know, short description. You know, and then of course there's also you know, karma.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, and we spoke about, you know, the wounded healer. You know, so there are all kinds of reasons why things happen in your life. To always ask the right questions, to keep asking. You know,
right.
Keep on learning.
Right.
And, you know, what else are you going to do in your life?
Right. Exactly. Except be programmed and do what people tell you to, right? No.
Yeah, you can keep running in a hamster wheel and trying to match what's in your magazine is shown to you in the magazine. You know, try to match that.
Right.
Keep you busy. And
right.
Keep you,
and come back and do it again next lifetime, right?
Yeah, you know, back into the matrix or Maya, you know, Maya, the yogis right. call this Maya.
Right. And speaking of like mental health and empaths, anxiety and depression, many empaths experience anxiety and depression. I mean, everybody does, but because, you know, we're feeling everything. Why do you think that is? Is it mainly from feeling the emotions of everyone around us and the human collective? Is it because we're overwhelmed easily by noise or something, you know, in our environment? Is it because we care so deeply and want to fix everything? Or is it everything?
The last one, you know, all of these, you know, yeah. especially for ET souls.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're having here thousands of years of karma yeah. and negative thought forms floating around.
Yes.
I mean, from battles, a lot of sacrifices have been done, you know, black magic sacrifices. And, you know, and also, you know, all humans, you know, are deeply wounded, again, you know, from past life trauma, you know, and they're out of balance.
Yeah.
And, I mean, you know, my parents, you know, coming out of the war, Second World War, I mean, completely traumatized.
Absolutely. You know?
And so completely out of balance, right?
Right.
Did not receive love themselves, you know, how can those poor people give love? You know, it just right. comes out quirky, you know, everything is kind of twisted. And then, of course, you know, we are guided or goaded into, you know, living a, you know, life of gross materialism,
mm-hmm.
you know, that is actually deeply unfulfilling, you know, and yes. that separates, you know, us from nature and, yeah. and the more sublime.
Yeah.
You know, nowadays, much of our focus is like, you know, focused on a small screen.
Absolutely. So much. Yeah.
I mean, I have big screen. I have three screens here at least.
Right.
And nice speakers, nice headphones. You know, I have a slightly bigger spectrum. But most people are just focused like here. And,
yes.
You know, which separates you from nature, from the earth, from the stars, you know, the bigger picture.
Absolutely.
From the sun. You know?
Yeah.
And when you look at people's faces, you know, how much joy do you see them all the time? You know, I mean, just look, you know, just look. You know, and so, yeah, I once, you know, when I was struggling, you know, I was considering doing a security job, you know, for a casino.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I went to check out the casino and, oh my God, there was not one smiling face.
Isn't that true?
Yeah, it wasn't yeah. like, jackpot, hoo, yeah. No, it was like, you know, negative, dull, you know,
right.
depressed. And so, yeah, of course, I didn't want to work there. But, you know, so sorry, empath, you know, you see reality. You know, and at the moment, reality sucks, you know.
Yeah.
And so it's up to you, you know, to change this. You know,
absolutely.
It's you have your little sphere of influence, you know, your family or the people that you are, you know, around. Even if you go into a convenience store, your bubble of influence goes with you. And,
yeah.
you know, make it nicer, you know, be funny, smile, be gentle, you know, be just kind. You know,
yeah.
project love, and you will be, you know, create the world, you know, wherever you can, every decision you make, you know, for a better world. You know, if you have a choice between organic and non-organic, if you can afford it, go for organic. You know, if you go low vibrational food, high vibrational food, go for the higher vibrational food. You know, I mean, gradually you will, you know, just elevate yourself. You know, you have a whole lifetime.
Right.
To do so, you know, and look at old people, you know, how they end up, you know, and do you want to end up like this or that, you know, or you want to be healthy, you know, joyful and happy when you're old, you know, so always consider.
Yeah, the one thing we can control is us, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's the one thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we can create what we can create around us and in us. So, do you notice that it's common for empaths to want to heal others, but we forget to work on healing ourselves?
Well, this is an old problem, you know? I mean, it was even, I think, Jesus in the Bible. You know, I remember this from Bible school, you know, not being able to see this, the splinter in your, being able your to see eye. The splinter in the eye of another, but not seeing the beam in your own eye.
Absolutely. You know? And
I don't mean the Jim Beam here. So, it takes guts, you know, to face, you know, your own demons and your own trauma. It doesn't feel good, you know. It feels, you know, bad if you, you know, think you're insufficient or you know. This is something to overcome, and, you know, and we are very biased, you know, and attached to notions about ourselves, you know. But we can be very detached about others.
It's true.
Right? You know, maybe a little too critical because of jealousy and envy.
Right.
So it's very difficult to work on yourself. You know, it takes this being able to step outside of yourself and to look at yourself, you know, from a more objective point of view, you know, and many people, you know, don't want to be photographed because they don't like what they see. Oh, what the hell? You not change yourself, you know?
Right.
I mean, it's like, it's not the camera. We have to look at you anyhow, you know? It's just, you know, make it nicer. Make it, you know, make it so you like what you see, you know? I mean, what's wrong, you know? It's like you get rid of all the mirrors around. Is that the solution?
It isn't. It really isn't.
Yeah, you know? So it's difficult to look at your own mistakes, you know, and much
better. Mm-hmm.
But then you also have another thing in there, you know, and this is the principle of the Mahayana Buddhism, you know. The Maha means, you know, big or above or superior, you know? Mm-hmm. And Yana is kind of the path, you know. So this is the superior path of Buddhism. And here in essence is like you focus on also helping others to become enlightened, you know?
Yeah.
And in my personal experience, you know, I have done this now for many, many, many years.
Yes.
The more I help others, the more I get help. You know, this goes hand in hand, just like a tangle. And so, you know, if I'm in alignment also, you know, when you try to help others, you know, there is this phenomenon of getting empowered.
Mm-hmm.
You know, suddenly, you know, there are energies coming over you and intuitions and insights and protection that you did not have normally.
Absolutely.
You probably experience this yourself. You know, you're counseling and suddenly, you know, you're spouting this wisdom out and you're just watching and you're like, wow.
Where did that come from?
Where is that coming from? Oh, wow, I'm feeling great suddenly, you know.
Yeah.
I could hardly get out of bed this morning and now I'm cruising, riding the tiger.
Absolutely. Right?
You're getting empowered, you know, by higher beings. They're pouring a lot of chi and smiles on you. Yeah, we need this done. We need this done here.
Right. You know?
So this is, you know, a nectar that comes to you, and you can get addicted to this, you know.
That's not a bad thing, is it? No, that wouldn't be
look
bad.
Look at me now. You know? I mean, this is,
exactly.
I'm doing welfare work, you know, for the world, and this is going to affect hundreds, maybe thousands of people. You know, change their perspective a little bit, raise their vibration, you know, by tuning into our vibration, you know. So, you get help.
You really do.
So, you know, so that is, and then, of course, much of, you know, the work from this higher dimension is just holding space, you know, and just projecting love of the universe, you know, onto the people. So, you know, they're getting the stuff and, you know, you're getting your side benefits too.
Right. That's interesting. different topic again. Changing the channel. Romantic relationships. A lot of my clients talk to me about their struggles in that area. Do you notice that it's common for empaths to lose their sense of self almost entirely in romantic relationships? And what are some ways that empaths can have healthy romantic relationships?
Well, losing the sense of self, it's kind of the goal of popular,
true.
Right?
True.
You know,
true.
you become one, you know, your energies become right. one and become more in a synergistic way, right? This is the higher right. tantric love.
Right.
And it's just the dysfunction. Losing your sense of self that we have, you know, to worry, you know. I mean, yeah. In my opinion, you know, only an empath can have a decent love relationship. You know?
That is so true.
I mean, only an empathic woman, you know, would be, you know, good for romance. You know? I mean, even, you right. know, and, you know, sex, yeah, it's just fly here. The law
that
of applies
you alone.
You get attracted to the energy.
Mm-hmm. They do.
So, you know, and sexual and emotional abuse, you know, from this or past lifetime, you know, can cripple this empathy, you know, and then you have damaged goods.
Right.
And then people cannot enjoy, you know, sex or intimacy, you know, because that was shut down, you know.
Right.
So it's just too traumatic, you know.
Right.
And so the key is to, you know, clearing, you know, the trauma from past lifetimes.
Mm-hmm.
And so that there is no contamination there, you know. And well, again, you know, you have to be the source of love in yourself.
Right.
And, right. You know, if you expect, you know, love from somebody else, you know, it's probably not going to happen. You know,
right.
Because the more you chase after them, the more like, you know, get away from me, I feel.
Absolutely.
Clingy. I feel smothered, you know.
Right.
And, yeah, I mean, you know, men want to conquer, women want to conquer, right?
Right.
And, you know, when you have somebody following you out like a lovesick puppy, you know, it becomes, you know, disgusting or whatever.
Yeah, so too much.
Right. So again, you know, the once you can have access to this love from source on and heaven and earth, then only then you can become a decent lover, you know, because
right.
you're not attached. You know, you
right.
can enjoy the love and it gets really good, but because there is no attachment. You know, there, I mean, it's like okay, let's take junkie and heroin dealer. You know, they're going to have an unhealthy relationship, you know, unless, well, if the junkie has plenty of money, probably not so much of a problem. But that generally doesn't work like that, you know.
No.
And so, you know, the heroin dealer always, no, stay away from me, you know, give me the money before you get the goods, you know, don't make such a trouble here, you know, people are watching. You know, and the junkie, oh, no, I need you, I need more. And more
right? right?
So same thing. So that's
right. So learn to be your own supplier with having heaven.
Yes,
there.
Produce the drugs yourself.
Absolutely.
You know, be independent.
Yeah.
You know, that
yeah.
is the whole idea. And then, you know, you can have a paradise after that.
Right.
Because you're not dependent. You know, you don't have to right. change the world to fit your needs.
Right. So many times.
Well, it's a tough job to change the world, you know, it keeps you really busy.
It does. So what are some guidelines for empaths to know if someone is potentially a romantic partner that would be healthy and supportive?
Well, I mean, you got to be really careful. First of all, you know, with visual thinking, you know, and projecting, you know, of your own expectations onto others.
Right. You
know, I mean, that's like a big thing.
Yeah.
I mean, I would plot my next holidays, you know, after the first date. I was younger, you know. So, you gotta be really careful there, you know. Right. And because, you know, then you have disappointment. You know, when you have expectations, it's probably not going to work out exactly as you painting it out, you know?
Right. And
so, you're going to then, the more you paint, the more you're going to have disappointment when things are different. You know?
Yeah.
Also, you know, astrology charts, you know, can give you, you know, a deep insight. I mean, you know, you want to look at the mental, you know, connection. This is the position of your Mercury's. You know, because you want to be, you know, harmonious, you know, on the mental plane.
Right.
You know, you want to look at your emotional plane. You look at your moon and Venus, you know, and the Mars, you know, and of course other compatibilities. Because, you know, well, initially when you, you know, fall in love, you're all hyped up and full of natural drugs.
Right.
And everybody's on their best behavior, having their best clothes on and doesn't overeat and this and that, you know. And after familiarity, you know, comes in, you know, the dark side comes up. Mm-hmm. And so astrology, you know, can give you, you know, the, you know, whether this is solid or not, the long perspective.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And also, personally, you know, when clients come to me, I found a method, you know, where I don't take their power away. And first of all, you know, we talk to their inner child, how they're like the inner child of the other guy or person, you know. Then we ask the inner teen how they relate to the other person's inner teen.
Interesting. Okay.
You know, it's and then also the high self aspect, you know, male and female sometimes, you know, what they think about the whole thing. You know, they have the big picture, you know, it's a karmic picture, you know. And then we also look at and clear past life influences, like, you know, bad karma, you know, promises, vows, spells, bindings, curses, you know, glamours and ghosts. You know, many times there are ghosts from other, from old relationship, you know, either very angry or very attached, you know.
Yes.
And they interfere. You know?
Yeah.
And so all this, or other beings, you know, so that all has to be taken care of. You know? And the more you do this, you know, the more, the noise and disturbances in the relationship, you know, get cleared out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Let me see. I think we're getting close to the end of my questions. Is that possible? Let me see. From a spiritual perspective, do we choose to be empaths? You've kind of already answered this, but or is it part of our soul that we carry from lifetime to lifetime?
Yeah. I mean, being an empath, you know, is part of your soul. You look at all the animals, you know, if you're the animal that has been estranged, you know, that got kicked out of the Garden of Eden, you know, being stuck on the mental plane, the knowledge of what is right and wrong, not the feeling of what is right and wrong, the knowledge. You know?
So true. So true.
You know, and also being an empath, you know, is part of our brain, you know. And I mean, there is a dedicated area, you know, to create a reproduction of the emotional patterns of another person. I mean, this has been scientifically proven, you know, through resonance patterning, you know, or whatever this is called.
Right.
So there is a path. Mm-hmm. There is a mirroring path.
Mm-hmm.
And so, of course, you know, this can be larger and smaller. And of course, also there is, you know, astrology. You know, I mean, first of all, you know, if you're Pisces or Cancerian, you know, you're going to be very sensitive.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, and of course, birth time is generally chosen. And then, of course, you know, DNA and also personal history, you know, of course, they all modify this to some degree. And, you know, then there are also like past life skills and pedigrees, you know, that we have, you know, as accumulated as priests and healers, mystics like hermits, and I mean some of those past lives regressions into like Atlantis or ancient times, you know, they're very interesting, you know.
I bet.
People connect to energies and other beings.
Right, right. There's a lot to take in and consider, for sure.
Yeah.
So my very last question, in your opinion, what is the best way empaths can be of service to humanity at this time?
Well, first of all, you know, I'm not necessarily here for the service of humanity just because I'm a human, you know. I don't want to be too partial.
There is more than just humanity, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, you know, yeah. Humanity has turned into, you know, cancer, you know, on this planet, right? So we have, you know, killed many of the life forms, you know, they're just disappearing at an alarming rate. You know, we managed, you know, to pollute, you know, those vast oceans, you know. And so when you take, you know, Mother Earth as a body, like a human body, you know, I mean, we are like a cancer, you know, we reproduce uncontrolled. We pollute, you know, just like cancer cells do, you know, with their side products, with their toxins, and are very, very destructive.
Yes.
So I'm not necessarily, you know, parting with this type of humans.
Right. I agree.
My job, you know. No. I'm here as a peacemaker, you know, and maybe as a teacher.
Yeah.
And to help people, you know, wake up. So, So it's the thing is to raise mass consciousness and the vibration, right? So you have to heal yourself, you know, and raise your own vibration, you know. Yeah. And, you know, personally, I think you have to perfect the pumping of love, you know, and apply this to the calling of your heart.
Right.
So a calling of your heart is like whether you're a musician or you are an artist or you are, you know, somewhere in administration. And, you know, there are ways that are with love and kindness, you know. I'm not saying being stupid or pushover. You know,
right.
I'm not a pushover, for surely.
Yeah.
Not.
Right. Big difference. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I have a hawk I can let out.
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, it's like applying these, you know, you will again transmute and maybe you bring in new ideas. Maybe you bring in new ways of doing things, you know, improving the system, I call this. You know?
Yeah.
But, you know, always stay connected to heaven and earth, you know, and stay in your heart and you will be fine. You know, this is the important thing, you know, to stay connected with your earth, so you're in harmony with your earth world. You know, you survive, you can pay the rent, you have a strong body. And then also stay connected with the heavens so the positive can come in, the love, the higher vision, you know, the divine. You know? And mix that and then project that, you know, then you're a good everything.
Right. It's true. It's really true. Healing ourselves and staying in tune with earth and heaven. And like you're saying, putting that love out there into whatever you're doing is whatever your calling may be is where it's at for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You have a good time and everybody else has a good time. You know, everything what we do should be an expression of love.
Absolutely.
I just recently there was a big insight I had. I as a child, I grew up very isolated. You know, my mom did not know how to play, and I did not know how to play. You know, we grew up isolated. You know?
Right.
And so I asked my inner child, you know, to ask another person's inner child that's very dear to me, you know, how do you play? You know, how should I play? You know, and the answer was to play. The playing is just an excuse to exchange love.
Mm.
Right? So let's say you play grocery store. Yeah, I like to have a pound of peace. Here, a pound of peace. What else can we do? You know,
aww.
You know, whatever exchange it is, you know, you make it funny. It is just an excuse of exchanging love. And wow. My inner child, I started to cry. I always play to win.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that didn't
that is, no, but that is the way so many of us have done it. It's the way we're programmed. Wow, that is actually profound. That's very beautiful. Everything is an exchange of love.
It should be.
Yeah.
It's opportunity. Yeah. It's an opportunity as an exchange of love.
Wow. Wow. That is beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah, this is, you know, also a gift of love, you know, a gift of love for the world.
Absolutely.
And the perfect breathing exercise, you know, this is difficult, but this is, I think, ultimately the best breathing is, you know, you take in the love on the inhale from all around you. You know, it's all conscious, it's all creator, it's all God, it's all source. And you send your love in all directions. Again. And you go back and forth. As what you give out, you get back. You put love out, means you have to smile, you know, love comes back. So that's the way above, just running heaven on earth.
But, absolutely.
But it's also more difficult, so it, you know, but you got a lifetime to perfect it.
That's right.
It's a default. God, I got all teary here.
I know, I was starting to swell. I kept trying to stop myself from crying.
Yeah, in many of my sessions, you know, I get really teary.
Yeah.
It's just strong emotions. That's
it is.
Strong
it
emotions. Is. And that's the beauty of an empath.
Yes.
You know, you can have very strong and but also very refined emotions. You know, that is the advantage.
Superheroes, superpowers.
All right. So I hope everybody watching this enjoys this. Do you have information how people can contact you?
On my website, I'm at empathcentral.com. I'm also pretty active on Facebook at Empath Central. So that would be the easiest.
Okay, guys. So if you feel called, you know, to work with her, there she is. And as always, you know, just take everything we said with a grain of salt. See what vibrates and resonates with you. You have your own BS meter. And, you know, do the cyber stuff, right? Subscribe, ring the bell, give a thumbs up, and keep smiling like an idiot. Project love everywhere. I love you. Namaste.
Namaste.